Be gentle with me, please. I know the theories, but where's Sam? Especially you, right? Take your time. You have enough time because it will be very short, relatively short. We'll talk about the current Cornyn concept, the Cornyn model. Then we talk about fatigue. We call it the central governor model. And we'll get to it through the lecture that Sean is prepared, and I modified it, so I can be able to speak about it. Well, there's a pointer, we use this one.
Use that one, that door works.
It works?
Oh, not that, sorry.
Use the monkey.
I don't.
Well done. There is a debate in exercise science. I don't know how many old people are here to remember the debate about the anaerobic threshold. Here, between Carl Wasserman and George Brooks. This is the new debate in exercise physiology about fatigue. And we're presenting some side of it today about the nature of fatigue that determines exercise performance under different conditions. And there are several definitions that you can use for fatigue. You can use the dictionary Oxford, extreme tiredness resulting from mental or physical exertion or illness. Like every dictionary, it covers everything. So it can help us as physiologists to go through it. Use a Tuomi definition, all exercise-induced reduction in ability of muscle to generate its force or power, reversible by rest, of the French group. The performance fatigability is reduced objective physical measures over a discrete period of time. That's another definition. The perception of fatigue is subjective experience, and we'll talk about it later on. Probably Sam will expand on that. Now you can look at the physiological model. There are several physiological models. Go through them quickly. Talk about the cardiovascular anaerobic model. Avi was talking about part of it, basically the basic physiology of the muscle. A.V. Hill started the idea behind the lactate, or the uptake in the physiology limitation of the muscle. And this is actually presented as a second model here. The one that I presented here will talk about the cardiovascular anaerobic model, which basically is saying that endurance exercise is determined by the capacity of the heart to pump large volume of blood and oxygen to the muscle. And the muscle can achieve a higher work rate before the developing anaerobiosis as a limiting factor for continuing the exercise. Anaerobiosis state, physiological state, is the limiting factor for continuing the exercise, what we consider as fatigue. And we actually can reach higher level before reaching that anaerobic acid. And training will increase the cardiovascular fitness, and we'll be able to increase higher level of work rate before we reach this level of so-called fatigue. And the termination of exercise must occur before the heart actually reaches maximum capacity. This is part of what we can understand from this model. And it occurs before the skeletal muscle anaerobiosis can be developed. So we can reach higher level, and then we develop, because we cannot increase it more, we start to relay more anaerobic processes and develop a state of anaerobiosis. Basically, it looks like that, the classical model of fatigue. And the heart has a limiting maximum cardiac output. At onset of plateau phenomenon, we cannot be increased anymore. Based on incorrectly on A.B. Hill, Archibald Hill works in the beginning of the 19th, 20th century. And the result, the blood and oxygen to the exercise muscle fall behind demand, induce anaerobic metabolism, metabolites of anaerobic metabolism, particularly hydrogens, accumulate and inhibit muscle contraction and induce fatigue. Now the problem with this model are simple studies that have been done in altitude. You know how much of you know about the George Brooks altitude in the 1990 and 1989, 1990? And some of them did exercise physiology at extreme high level in the mountain. And they found out the lactate paradox, that the peak lactate during maximum exercise actually fall with increasing altitude. It doesn't make sense if you have less oxygen, less ability to create oxygen consumption. It should be increased earlier and higher level, and here we have a fall in that. That's a paradox. And the maximal heart rate and cardiac output fell during exercise at increasing altitude. We can explain it, but it's not going to through the model. So exercise at extreme altitude terminates when exercising muscle contracting fully aerobically, this not reaching an aerobiosis, as we said before. So maximum oxygen consumption, maximum cardiac output during exercise at increasing altitude must either stay the same or even increase in order to limit the effect of progressive reduction in arterial oxygen content. And the conclusion is the O2 demand of skeletal muscle aren't the cardinal priority. They are not protected during maximal exercise. Neither skeletal muscle nor the heart becomes anaerobic during exercise at the altitude. And there should be an unrecognized mechanism that to ensure that the heart does not become anaerobic during maximal exercise at any altitude. Now the classical model, I will not stay on there too much because actually saying what A.B. Hill was saying in 1924, so we'll skip to that quickly. We actually refer to it. I'll go as much as quickly as you be. Energy supply model. So we can say, according to what we heard before, that with a limiting supply, we can develop metabolic situation that will limit the exercise and will fall into fatigue. So fatigue in high intensity exercise may result from inability to supply ATP at a rate sufficient fast enough to sustain the exercise. Makes sense for every physiology, the basic science that we learn. The performance in event of different duration is determined by the capacity to produce ATP at different metabolic pathways. And we talk about the phosphorus again that Abby was talking about before, O2-dependent glycologists, aerobic glycologists, and anaerobic glycologists. Now, the superior performance is explained by increased capacity to generate ATP in specific metabolic pathway that's predetermined in that activity. So if we train ourselves, we'll be able to create more ATP and increase the capacity for that in specific pathways that allow us, sometimes specific to the sport. And when ATP production by oxidative stores are inadequate, in this case, we start to develop a problem in contractions, cross bridge cycling, and causing fatigue and failure for muscle contraction eventually. So this is the energy supply theory. Makes sense if you're looking from energy supply point of view. Now, the problem with this energy supply model, according to Noakes, is that the ATP, even in muscle force, the concentration ATP, even if in muscles that are forced to contract in ischemic condition, they do not drop below 60% of the resting value. So you don't see a drop that much specific in ATP to explain the supply or support the supply theory. Actually, this ATP concentration are defended in order to prevent developing of skeletal muscle rigor. If we go lower enough, we may develop a rigor. That's the reason that probably are being defended. A number of metabolites can interfere with muscle cross-bridging cycling measured in vitro in isolated muscle fiber. And the assumptions, basically, of skeletal muscle contracting in vitro in absence of intact neural system behave as it would be in vivo when affecting when effects from the CNS are intact. So we see a response that goes beyond the energy supply, that actually bypass the energy supply model, and we cannot explain it. We can assume that there are some neurological pathways involved, and we are not, that are not being answered by this theory. And there is a body of evidence that aren't compatible with this consumption and conclusion of the energy supply model. And this model is specific for exercise about from more than 2 hours in there, so not very long-term exercise. And depletion of endogenous carbohydrate stores was shown to be a limiting factor in ability to perform long-term exercises. And this is not compatible with the theory, because a depletion in endogenous carbohydrate storage was shown to be a limiting factor, but it's not compatible with the ATP theory that we described before. It's not going down below the 60% that we described before. So you can stay with a low carbohydrate, you can use a lipid storage, but still be above the 60% value of ATP, and it's not compatible with lower energy supply, because we have other sources of supply. Still, we're getting into fatigue. There's another energy model. Talk about the energy depletion model. The fatigue during prolonged exercise is associated with depletion of liver and muscle glycogen storage, and causing actually a relative hypoglycemia, or both of them, both sources. And the reversal of this hypoglycemia, protection from this hypoglycemia, allowed exercise to continue. If you keep supplying source for glycogen, supply other source for glucose during exercise, not from those resources and protecting for hypoglycemia, we may allow exercise to continue and not getting into fatigue. So we're actually preventing the depletion. The pre-exercise muscle glycogen supercompensation, some technique that some runners used to do, those carbohydrate loading techniques that we're familiar with, those parties that in front of any marathons or long distance competition, are based on this theory. Basically, by pre-exercise loading, we can delay the onset of fatigue. It works to a certain limit. And we may think today that this is limitation. Basically, what the people believe is kind of a placebo effect, not necessarily something that we can rely on because of this problem that with this model. It's unclear how inability to produce ATP or sufficient high rates from one fuel source to explain fatigue, because they have another sources for depletion. And although we have other sources for other source of energy, and because we have other sources of energy, we're not supposed to get to fatigue, yet we are fatigued. We're reaching the fatigue level, although we still have other sources available. Given that skeletal muscle ATP concentration remain high at exhaustion, the point of exhaustion, again, we still don't have explanation for depletion if we still have higher level of ATP when we reach exhaustion sometimes. An athlete ingesting carbohydrates terminate exercise after 4 hours when their muscle glycogen and rate of oxygen after carbohydrate oxygenation were the same as value that measured 1 hour earlier when they weren't exhausted. So the exhaustion or fatigue are not occurring exactly when you see the depletion. There's no point of putting them together on a timeline and pointing at the time of depletion of carbohydrate and the time of exhaustion and fatigue. Muscle also, athletes also adapt to a fat diet, increased fat, high fat diet, can exercise to significantly lower muscle glycogen concentration at exhaustion than those that are carbohydrate adapted. So if we are adapted to a different source of energy, like fat, high fat diet, we can find a different level of fatigue, and this is not compatible with the theory. The provision of carbohydrate at high level, if we provide them, for instance, in IV intravenous carbohydrate at higher rate, those studies being done by providing carbohydrate intravenously, we were not able to extend exercise performance indefinitely. So if there is the depletion theory, if it's right, supplying carbohydrate enough enough rate during the exercise, we're probably supposed to prevent fatigue indefinitely, and we cannot reach that. Eventually, everybody is fatigued. Now, since all those models are not good enough for the physiology, in 1997, Tim Noakes came with this central governor model. And the governor model, central governor model, talk about the brain regulating the performance by regulating what you do with the rhythm. And that actors subconsciously alter the pacing strategy to ensure hemostasis. And it's preventing potential damage. All those governors, central governors, is there to protect us from creating a potential damage, like ischemia in various organs. And proper regulation of arousal, calmness, and focus may play an important role in the regulation of pacing. This is actually a gray zone, which actually getting closer to what you're talking about, because this is some of the psychological effect of preparation. It may be affected by balance of neurotransmitters, other peptide transmitters, and it's such a big, a large model that it covers almost everything, and some of the weaknesses of this model that you cannot attack it from one point of view because it covers so much of possibility. Now, if we try to follow this Tim Noakes theory and talk about how athletes initial pace, what initial pace is based on, then athlete physiology state at the start of the exercise obviously is important. The expected distance, duration of the intended exercise bout is important. Actually, the major cornerstone of this model, because what he's saying in the central governor theory or the model is you predict the distance you're going to run according to the distance that you know, your experience with this former competition. You're looking at other competition, and the perceptions that you have before you start running have an effect, not just the physiology state you're in it, but what you expect from this distance, duration, and the intensity of exercise about to be, actually gonna be important for when you're gonna develop fatigue, and whether you're gonna be first or second. But based on this theory, Tim Noakes saying that if you are considering the fact that you're gonna be second in a competition, you will be second. You consider it. Because you're preparing for it, you think about it, and you're preparing to accepting it according to his understanding. And this is an area that I'm not crossing between you and him, and you would like to explain it, because it's something that I feel he's covering in the large model, something that goes with you. You're saying it's a mess, but I'm saying there's so much option in this, and we'll see it in a minute. Do we have previous experience that the athlete had that said it before? He's standing on the front of the line before starting his competition. The experience before is some of something. Athlete level of motivation, athlete levels of self-belief. And during the exercise itself, he's getting continuous feedback from all organs, inform the central command of the full fuel reserves, rate of heart, of heat accumulation, hydration state, integrated to a regular exercise behavior by continuously modifying number of neurons, motor neurons recruited in the exercising limbs. So if I can put it together, what I understand from this model, you're standing on the line with your competitors before the start, the beginning. Your physiologic state, depending on the hydrations, carbohydrate loading, everything you prepare yourself physiology for this competition. Your state of mind, what you experienced in the past in this competition, who is your competitors, how long gonna be this, all those perceptions are important even before you started the race itself, and you're gonna, according to this model, will create the final result or the fatigue, or when you're gonna stop, or whether you will reduce your speed and finish second instead of continuing your speed and finish first. This anticipatory regulation of exercise performance is the basic cornerstones of Noakes' model. The key prediction according to that is regulation of performance reside in the central nervous system, potentially modified or modifiable by intervention that act exclusively on the central mechanism. Something that we are, as a physiologist, understand. For instance, if I teach control of breathing, when I talk about control of breathing, it has to do something with fatigue as well, because we fatigue because we're getting shortest of breath. The signals goes to the control of breathing is go to the medulla oblongata, with the center of breathing over there. But the other central in the brain that involved in the process, some of them is the pons that get a response, and the pons have two different centers. One of them sending inhibitory signals, the other one said excitatory signal. So it's a complex mechanism that have all the time signals coming and controlling the final result that goes to the muscle. Breathe faster, breathe deeper. And in this case, we're talking about commands or the afferent command that goes to the muscle about how much you're going to invest now in the competition, or whether you're going to reduce the rate, the exercise effort. So exercise pace is a set in anticipation. You are prone to perform according to what you expect or anticipated in the competition. And the protection of homeostasis require that there is always a skeletal muscle reserve during all form of exercise. No matter what you do, in order to prevent catastrophe, you will not go all the way, and there are some reserves that are not being used to preserve for you in the cardiac or muscle to prevent from catastrophe. Exercise intensity may increase near the end of exercise, it's the end growth, it's the sprint, what we call it, the end, even in the face of significant fatigue. And after afferent sensory feedbacks can modify the exercise performance, as I said before, in the control of breathing, similar to that. And brain regulates exercise in regards to neurally calculated safe exertion. That's what we are actually wants to be in. Neurally calculated safe exertion, something that prevents us from catastrophe to happen during the event itself. Physical activity is controlled. Its intensity cannot threaten homeostasis by causing anoxic damage to the heart muscle. And brain does not recruit more motor unit in prolonged exercise that will create a threat to homeostasis, which all those leading to, at best, premature termination of exercise. If you're getting close to this point, you will terminate the exercise, but a bit premature termination of the exercise to prevent the catastrophe. This is the best. At worst, there's going to be organ damage, failure, and even death. And this recruitment that we're talking about, the motor unit recruitment, causes sensational fatigue. The level of recruitment causing the sensational fatigue. Not getting into this. And we're going to summarize it by talking about exhaustion, prolonged exercise. Why does the brain fail to recruit additional motor units so exercise can continue? That's a big question. So the CNS defined the work rate that can be sustained, what we said before, according to anticipated duration of the exercise. The pacing strategy is adapted rapidly, it's occurring in the anticipation period, as in the 2-3 seconds of the first, 2-3 seconds of a 10-meter sprint, in the first few hundred meters of a long running event. And you actually, I can imagine myself, this is not something I can pinpoint, but you're looking at those groups that are running together. And after a few hundred meters, you can see that it's starting to separate. And they're not fatigued at this point. So they're separating according to what they anticipate from the running. They anticipate a certain pace, anticipate a certain competition, and they start to separate. The decision cannot be based on metabolic event in active muscle, since the metabolic steady state is not achieved so fast. The model does not exclude some metabolic metabolites, that some metabolites can impair skeletal muscle function. This model does not exclude it, so we can as a physiologist we can accept it. We know there are other metabolites. Embracing is a balance between biological system, emotional component. Back to you again, something that you're going to talk about it. Self-preservation and homeostasis during exercise, and exact combination of these factors leads to how hard we are able to push ourselves during the race. So CGM is basically a proposed CNS mechanism that takes as input info on energy needs, physiological state, various motivational drive, regular physical activity to take us to regulate physical activity, saving us from catastrophe failure. This is the conclusion of the CGM, you can say, and it helps us to regulate physical activity afferent input from the body, allowing the completion of a given task. So a proposed CNS mechanism, what we're talking about, it takes an input inflow on energy needs, physiological states, and various motivational drive to regulate physical activity while saving us from catastrophe failures, allowing us to complete a given task in a safe manner, and by a feedback control modified by afferent feedbacks from many physiological systems in continuous altering pacing strategy during the race itself. The sensation of fatigue, the conscious interpretation of this homeostasis. So we are sensing the fatigue according to how we interpret our current state of homeostasis during the race and how we anticipate it and how we feel. The perception of discomfort, you probably gonna elaborate on that, it progressively reduce the conscious desire to override this control mechanism, leading to reduced intensity or to termination of exercises if intensity cannot be reduced. Marathoners finish race without evidence of a catastrophe failure, confirming anticipation mechanism for central nervous system control in accordance with this model. Thank you.